in the very middle of an oasis, where luxuriant trees temper the sun's scorching rays, and where the life-giving waters of the River Barada come roaring down from Mount Hermon, changing the burning desert sands into a tropical paradise, lies Damascus, right at the edge of the Arabian Desert. Here the soil is so rich that even the laziest farmer can make a good living with his crude old plow. Damascus is the oldest inhabited city on earth. We can trace its history back 4,500 years, but it must be much older than that. For the Orientals believe that this is where the Garden of Eden used to be. And if Adam and Eve used a plow, it must have looked something like this. History tells us that when Muhammad got his first and only glimpse of Damascus from a hilltop, he exclaimed, "Man can have but one paradise. Mine is fixed above." And so he passed on. It was on this spot that Muhammad made his great renunciation. However, as we are not prophets, we decided to take a chance. And so we went down into Damascus, where we found a picturesque jumble of modern houses, old mosques, minarets, and still older ruins that bear silent witness to the many fierce battles that were fought for it down through the centuries. The tower in the distance is the Minaret of the Bride, built 1,200 years ago. These ruins surround the tomb of Saladin, the great warrior who fought the Crusaders and stopped Richard the Lionhearted. Between ancient Roman columns, we get glimpses of the Minaret of Isa, the oldest and tallest tower in Syria. The Muslims believe that on Judgment Day, Christ will appear on this minaret. The courtyard of the Umayyadi, the oldest and most imposing mosque in Damascus. Partially destroyed by fire, it is now being rebuilt. Here once stood a pagan temple, which was converted into a Byzantine basilica dedicated to Saint John the Baptist 1600 years ago. 400 years later, this basilica was made over into a Mohammedan mosque. Yet the Muslims still revere the memory of St. John, whose head, enclosed in a box of gold, is said to be buried under the mosque. All that remains of what was once a beautiful Roman triumphal arch, built 2,000 years ago. And as we look down, we see the famous street called Straight, known to Abraham and King David, and where Ananias went to the house of Judas to inquire for Saul of Tarsus. Shops, called bazaars, line this busy street, which follows a straight line right across the city from east to west. In this far-off land, where the easygoing spirit of the East prevails, the marketplace offers the nearest approach to bustle and activity. The buyers may be eager, and the sellers more eager still, but these Orientals make haste slowly. Sheep raising is profitable here, thanks to the rich pasture lands around Damascus. And wool is an important item of commerce. Caravans of camels bring the wool to the marketplace or deliver it to distant points. A general laziness pervades the whole place. Camels move about slowly, majestically, and some of them, realizing that they have reached their journey's end, squat down to rest without waiting for an invitation. Kipling was right. You cannot hurry the East. And we had to wait patiently while our native guide, Dragoman they call him, got himself all dolled up by an open-air barber. The outfit is simple enough, but it seems to satisfy the natives. And now, a few finishing touches, a few dabs of face powder to make him smell nice. And a mustache trim, and he is all set. Oh, Allie, you feeling better now? Well, that's fine. Let's go. And so, Allie takes us first to a stonecutter's tent. Here, we were amazed at the fine work these clever workers turn out with their primitive tools. They do not have even a blueprint or a drawing to guide them. They seem to dream their designs, which they proceed to transfer directly to the stone. Next, we marveled at the skill of this workman with his crude outfit. Just a rough old file and a vise that had seen better days. He is filing and shaping pieces of mother of pearl and makes them fit accurately in the hollows of a wooden ornament which he has carved out for the purpose. Damascus is famous for the beauty and delicacy of all kinds of inlay work carried out with ivory, bone, and mother of pearl. A fine example, a chair back exquisitely inlaid. Their beautiful designs often include quotations from the Quran. This inscription means, "He who has patience gets what he wants." Now, could any woman resist the temptation of buying this beautiful glove box? I ask you. A wood turner making spindles for a frame of lattice work. And as two hands are not sufficient, he has trained his foot to help out. With one hand, he draws a bow back and forth. The string of the bow is wound around the shaft of the lathe and makes a turn. And considering the crudity of the outfit, the accuracy of the final result is astonishing. After gouging a design out of metal, the artist hammers fine silver wire into the groove, producing a beautiful metal inlay. And this is how the grooves are cut into the metal with a graving tool. Oh, it takes a sharp eye and a steady hand. But other metal objects are hammered out and chased without the use of inlay work, like this beautiful tray, for instance. A typical Arabian coffee pot, hammered out of brass. And a brass bowl with Arabic inscriptions taken from the Quran. Old age broods over this place, the strange old age of the East that is like no other antiquity. Romantic, fatalistic, and how wonderfully serene. Just outside of Damascus stands the mosque and pilgrim's house built by the Turkish Sultan Selim more than 400 years ago as a resting place for the weary pilgrims returning from Mecca. Twice daily, from the top of one of these graceful minarets of yellow stone, the muezzin chants his call to prayer. Let's listen. Come to prayer. I testify there is no God but God. I testify that Muhammad is the apostle of God. And as the Muslims reverently kneel in accordance with their faith, we silently leave Damascus, the magic city, immortal.